Dogumentary TV, producing the best breed documentaries on YouTube.
Hi, I'm Christine Robinson. I'm married to Stuart Robinson. We've been in Black Russian Terriers now for about 10 years. Started with AKC registered dogs back in the 80s. I started with herding breeds, which introduced me to that working mentality. I started with German Shepherds and then Australian Shepherds, and we bred. When my husband and I met, he had AKC registered Shih Tzus. He was a breeder, and I had AKC registered Dobermans. I worked my dogs, but I did not show. The Doberman Pinscher is very compliant and easily trained and will do anything you ask, but it doesn't think independently. And that's something that a Black Russian Terrier does, which can be exciting and frightening at the same time. In my experience, the Black Russian Terrier is a highly intelligent breed, often more intelligent than its owners. They will outthink you. They will anticipate what you need. And sometimes they'll even make decisions for you. We've been experimenting with a lot of the different sports that dogs enjoy. But one of the things we focus on is conformation, and after several years, we've become breeders as well. Back in the 1930s, the Russian military had a need for a Russian working dog. They started the Red Star Kennels, but they didn't really get far along into the breed until the 1950s, where they had a lot of success. There weren't a lot of purebred dogs left in Europe, and particularly in Russia, due to wars. So they had to start from scratch. After World War II, they were able to import purebred quality dogs from Germany, and they started with dogs with the best working temperament, the Giant Schnauzer and the Rottweiler. With selective breeding, they eventually introduced both the Newfoundland and the Airedale. It's rumored that there's about 17 different breeds altogether. This was all done with the military. They worked with different breeders to get good quality stock, perfecting what they thought was a good quality dog, and eventually were breeding true in the late 50s and wrote their first standard. Now, it's evolved a lot since then. The coats were quite harsh and certainly didn't have a lot of the furnishings that we see today in the show ring with the beard and the fall and all of that. It was a harsher coat. It was an all-weather coat. It protected their eyes and their bodies from the temperature. They do have a double coat. It's insulated. It helps them in both heat and cold. And they keep that today. Even though we trim it for show, we still maintain that double coat. Initially, the Russians were looking for a solid working dog that would handle any environment, harsh winters, and be adapted to a variety of different tasks. They were looking to breed something that they could use sort of all-purpose military. So there will be times when the dog would be working independently, guarding borders, or working, for example, at a military facility or a prison, making sure that there was no one there that shouldn't be there. They were used to guard food storage facilities and chemical plants and things like that. But they also did work with the military police and worked at border crossings. So they had to be pretty versatile to work independently and both with a handler. And then, of course, they had to handle the harsh Russian winters. Some of the Russians have taken a long time to put together a very in-depth database that's available online. It's in three different languages. And some of us can trace our dogs back to the original two dogs, the Giant Schnauzer and the Rottweiler that were bred that started this. The Black Russian Terrier is not a true terrier. It is in name only. And I believe that came about because it did have several breeds behind it, including the Airedale Terrier, which is probably where it got a lot of its intelligence because it's a very smart dog. The Airedale Terrier does come out in the breed from time to time. We don't have a rich or a deep history, genetically speaking, so we do get throwbacks in both color and type. But the terrier type is quite excitable, and that's really not good in a dog that weighs 100 plus pounds and is used for guard work. The Black Russian Terrier we have today breeders have been very careful in the last 30 years to breed in a temperament that we can live with, because this truly was a military dog, and it was not a companion, and it did work independently, and it may not even bond well with its handler. So we've evolved since then, and we've gotten a dog that does work well in families, and we can, you know, consider a companion dog. And because of that, we've lost some of the characteristics that made it an exceptional guard dog. Instinctually, it is still a very good guard dog, but that's not something we need to teach. It's something it does naturally. So some of the things about IPO training and Schützen work are contradictory to the Black Russian Terrier's nature as it is today. In IPO work and other Schützen types of training, you're looking to get a dog very excited and teaching it to bite a sleeve. That is contradictory to a Black Russian Terrier's nature. Of course it could be taught to do that, but the Black Russian Terrier wants to take down that person or that threat. It might be fun or exciting to bark at it, but it's not interested in the sleeve. It's gonna go through the throat, or it's gonna knock the person down. The other part of that stuff is, you know, there's a lot of tracking work involved, and some of these dogs do excel at tracking, but it's not the norm. That tracking is an individual sport. It's something that a dog would do on a long lead far away from its handler with a different focus. This breed tends to be very owner and handler focused and wants to stay with you and be with you. Their true temperament, naturally, they were bred to work independently, but because they were like that, we had to introduce dogs and breeds like the Newfoundland that help calm their temperament and make them more stable and balanced and easier to be companions. Today's Black Russian Terrier is not as independent-minded as the original was bred. It's not quite as aloof and suspicious of strangers, although that's still in the temperament, it's still there, but they are better family and companion dogs today. The breed standard calls for a large, robust dog. This is not a giant breed, but it is a large breed. It has to have a lot of bone and muscle mass. A big head is the hallmark of the breed, but it has to be substantial all the way through the body. If it's terrier type, it's not correct. There are a lot of dogs in the ring that are a little bit too tall or a little too narrow and thin, and when you think about what they were bred to do, to take down a large man, that probably wouldn't work. For the girls, they're between 26 and 28 inches tall and weigh between 80 and 120 pounds on average. There are a lot of smaller specimens, but as long as they are substantial in mass, that's good. The males tend to be larger. The breed standard calls for between 27 and 29 as being the preferred height, but there are examples in the ring today that are closer to 30 inches and some even taller. They average in weight between 110 and 140 pounds. Again, we're looking for a more substantial dog. Because they were bred to work independently, function follows the form, and so we have to have good structure. So the balance between the front and the rear is really important. We have to have a good level top line. We need to have good tight feet. All of these things contribute to the dog being able to cover a lot of ground. We talk about reach and drive. They have to be able to push with their rear, reach far with their front, and cover a lot of ground. They do this in a single track, meaning if you were to look at their feet pattern in the snow, it wouldn't look like there were 4 feet running. You just see three, and the 2 feet converging in the center, meeting in the same footprint almost. And that helps them to conserve energy as they're running long distances and covering a lot of ground. Because it's a large breed dog, there are some pretty obvious health issues. Joint and structure is really important. Hip dysplasia is very common in our breed. Probably closer to 50% of the breed has hip dysplasia. We don't often see lameness with it, but we do see joint wear and tear, which can break down the dog over time. Elbow dysplasia is another problem in our breed. When you look at the majority of the weight of the dog being carried in a very deep chest and a very big head, there's a lot of weight on the front. So good sound elbows are important. I'd say about 30% of the breed suffer from elbow dysplasia. Other issues that we have in our breed include heart problems. Vet checkups would pick up the majority of heart issues. We don't need a cardiologist for that, but it's important to check the heart every year. There are eye issues in the breed. It's not very common, but it does happen. They do have a lot of hair in their eyes, so trimming around their eyes is necessary for good eye health. In general, they're a pretty healthy dog. There are some that have allergies, there are some that get ear infections, but for the most part, good diet and good grooming practices will prevent a lot of those problems. The Black Russian Terrier, every time we listen to a dog show on national television, the announcer says it's not for the first-time dog owner. And I can't say that's 100% true. I think it depends on the dog owner. As we talked about before, Black Russian Terriers are highly intelligent. They need structure and they need obedience. They don't need a heavy hand and they don't need harsh punishment. They're very compliant. They're the dog that you could have a sentence conversation with instead of a one-word command and they'd know what you mean. What's important with them is socialization and training. We talk about socialization as though it's something that happens once, but it's not. It's something that happens multiple times over the life of the dog. They go through a lot of mental and physical changes from puppyhood through adulthood. A puppy might come home at 8 weeks and be close to 20 pounds, and by the time it's 9 months old, it's 100 pounds. So you can imagine the physical challenges that it's going through, and at the same time, it's mentally developing. So we try to socialize as much as possible when they're young, and we get basic obedience. They mature a little bit, sexual maturity hits, whether or not we're neutering or spaying isn't the issue, the brain changes, and we need to revisit socialization and obedience again. I think it's good to go back again when you get full maturity. That could be at 2 or 3 years old. Some breeds take as, or some lines take as long as 4 years to physically mature. But all throughout that time, we should continue repetition. Classes, socialization, meeting different people, going to different places. One of the things that's really important to teach our dogs from puppyhood, and we start this in the whelping box, is how to be groomed. This is a dog that has intensive grooming needs throughout its life. It has hair, not fur, and it continues to grow and grow and grow. It's not going to stop when it's 2 inches long or 6 inches long. It has webbed feet, and hair grows between the toes. It will end up with long furry slippers and slide all over the floor, and that instability in foot in the foot placement could have implications for hip dysplasia or injuries. So we talk about the hair growing, it grows in the ears, it grows in the eyes. So from the time that they're in the whelping box, as soon as they're able to stand, we start putting them on grooming tables. We expose them to things like clippers and trimmers, because for the life of the dog, you're going to be trimming the hair between the feet and around the toes. You're going to be trimming the hair in and around the ears, in and around the eyes. Whether or not you show isn't the issue. If you don't show, you're still going to need to get that dog clippered every 2 months. So it's an intensive process. It's definitely worth it because they're great dogs, but there's a lot that goes into it. So all of those types of things, plus the socialization, plus obedience, are really important. Fleur is about 5 years old right now. She weighs just under 115 pounds. She's a little on the thin side, having had puppies last year. She's 28 inches tall. She's a conformation champion, and we do have all of her health clearances as well. She finished her conformation championship, going best of breed over all the specials in the ring. It was kind of an exciting big win. She was top 20 owner handled when she was out showing. She is a champion in several different registries, but I focus mostly on AKC because of the quality of the registry. She has had one litter, and you got to see one of her kids, Michael. I'm kind of excited about that litter. They seem to be pretty big-boned boys, but they seem to have good temperaments, good quality coats. I'm really liking their conformation so far. There are 4 dogs out of that litter that are showing. Michael has 2 of his majors towards his conformation championship, and he's only 9 months old, so I'm pretty proud of him. He's done well. Right now, Michael's a little over 29 inches tall, and he is also 115 pounds. He's going to be a big boy. Odessa is 13 months old now. She's my little star. She's a Ukrainian import from Terra Avalon Kennels. Good quality kennels, great structure. She finished her AKC championship just barely 11 months. She won Best of Breed over all the specials at the Beverly Hills Kennel Club Dog Show this past March, and she got her debut on national television. We were kind of proud. She's been working with a handler, but I show her myself. She's just got great conformation, great structure. We're really excited to see what she'll be in the future. She's just under 28 inches tall right now and right around 100 pounds, but she's a pretty solid, compact girl. At 6 months old, she won Winner's Bitch at our national specialty for a 5-point major, going over all of the older entries, and we were quite proud of her for doing so. She's definitely one to watch in the future. You saw dogs today that are both docked and undocked. Docked was always part of the standard. It was preferred in working dogs. There's a lot of reasons why people think that's true. But in any event, docking is traditional. There are several countries that do not dock. So we have imports, for example, Odessa from the Ukraine, that is undocked. That natural tail is not penalized at all. It is still carried above the back in a sickle or saber shape. And I noticed that dogs with the tails tend to have a little better coordination at a younger age than dogs who are docked. I've got two of each, and so I'm kind of looking to see the differences, and I've noticed that the dogs with the tails, they jump higher and further and do tend to be more agile. I think the Black Russian Terrier can be a good family dog with the right family, and balance and understanding structure is so important. If you've got children, talk with your breeder about how their dogs are with children. They're not all great with kids. Some dogs have a stronger prey drive and may react suddenly and want to chase things that are small or move quickly. That's cats, rabbits, children, you name it. So it's really important. We don't have a lot of depth of history, so there's different coat types. There's different temperaments. Some are going to be more friendly. Some are going to be more wary of strangers. Some are going to be better at guarding. Others are going to be better at a therapy dog. So since we have such a wide diversity, you need to talk with more than one breeder if you're talking about getting a Black Russian Terrier. Do whatever you can to meet one in person. Dog shows are great places to meet them, but there's other places too. They do barn hunts, they do dock diving, they do lure coursing. There's different places, but it's important to really have a good picture of everything that's going to be required. They're expensive to feed. They're expensive to groom unless you do it all yourself. And there's a lot of different ways that puppies are raised. So talk to different breeders. Don't be concerned about going outside of your state to find just the right one. It's important. They have different philosophies. You want to know that they do health testing. You want to know what their success has been in the conformation ring. Things like that are important to ensure that you get a good, healthy puppy and hopefully have a good long life with your dog. This is Christine Robinson with Black Beard Black Russian Terriers. Thank you guys for watching.